No, this is not a song about a convenience store in Pennsylvania. But it is called Wawa. Not Wawa, like Wawa, but Wawa. And it's by George Harrison off his 1970 album, All Things Must Pass. It's a perfect album. It's also number 433 out of 500 on the Spotify Ridge, the 500 with me, the King Kadoogal. What's up, you Kadoogly Spooglies? Thanks again for joining me. We're going from 500 down to 1, from Rolling Stone magazine's list of best albums. All right. Usually, I would read this long thing about the artist to catch you up on what's going on. But because we have such a... I mean, this album just destroyed me. I've realized that why I'm doing this is because when I listen to certain songs and certain albums, that is when I'm with Angelo. Like, literally 5 minutes before I started recording this, I was just torn apart just listening to this album and how powerful it is. And it's like, that's when I feel my friend that's gone. And it's beautiful. So I mean this from the bottom of my heart. Thank you to every single one of you guys for joining this journey. And I hope you're getting the same experiences that I am, because we don't get like an album like this for the first time in our life. There's people that have listened to this and are probably jealous of us that we get George Harrison, All Things Must Pass, all the way through from start to finish. That's so dope. So listen, like, I could read this long thing about George Harrison, but you know everything about this guy, okay? He was a Beatle, the biggest band in the world from like 63 to 70. And he was like writing songs, you know, over time, but the Beatles, like John and Paul, were like pushing him down and pushing him down. And so he sat in the cut and he didn't do shit, but he kept writing songs. And then finally, after the Let It Be sessions, when shit got all kinds of ka-chunked, because he couldn't take working with these guys and they couldn't take working with him and it was falling apart, the band broke up. And then he, meaning George, got together with Phil Spector, bought a briar out in the middle of like Castle Land, where they shoot Game of Thrones in England, and recorded this album using Phil Spector's wall of sound. And there were incredible musicians on it, like Belly and Billy Preston, Eric Clapton, Bob Dylan and the band helped influence. There's just so much cool shit in this. And it's an incredible album. Slide guitar, everything you're gonna need. Not going any further. It's one of the best albums. Also, I am not one to protest at all about the placement of any albums on this Rolling Stones list. That's not my job. I am the voice. I am the conduit that gets all of you to listen to it, you know? I am the scratchy fucking Harvey Fierstein sounding voice that you get to enjoy every week that guides you through this. But the fact that All Things Must Pass is in the top 400 is fucking stupid. You're telling me the Arctic Monkeys had a better album than George Harrison unloading one of the most incredibly godly albums of all time? Forget that he's a Beatle, because there's no way a Beatle should be in the fucking top 400. This is a God-gifted movement of an album. So what if there's 9 versions of Isn't It a Pity? The album's special. The guy looks like a goddamn garden gnome on the cover, and that's the point. The record label knew the album was so goddamn good, they let him dress up like the Keebler elf on the cover, and they were like, okay, George Harris Kadoogly, you can have your little witch's hat and sit on the briar, but just please put out your symphony. And you know what he said? He said, Kadoogly. And my guest today knew him, was there for all of this. It's Peter Asher. If you don't know who Peter Asher is, he was a child star of radio, television, screen. His sister Jane dated Paul McCartney at the beginning and at the height of Beatlemania. And even Paul lived with Asher's family during that time. And then Peter was in the 60s duo Peter and Gordon, where they were like the British version of the Everly Brothers. They released all these songs like World Without Love. It was a big hit. This dude became the head of A&R at the Beatles record label, Apple Records. He was the dude that discovered James Taylor. He produced Linda Ronstadt. This dude is a legend. He even wrote a book called The Beatles from A to Z, an alphabetical mystery tour. And he is our guest today, and I couldn't be happier. Rate, review, and most importantly, subscribe to The 500 and listen free on Spotify or anywhere you get your pods. Follow me at Josh Adam Myers on all social media. Email the podcast at 500podcast@gmail.com. And for all things 500, go to our website, the500podcast.com. Well, guys, let's get tet. Let's get tet. You want to get tet? Here we go. Oh, with number 433 out of 500, jing, bing, with all things must pass by George Harrison, Harrison. Sometimes you have a guest like Peter Asher. Sometimes you have Peter Asher. I feel like you're cracking a little smile.
Okay. I'm polite.
You're so sweet.
I'm doing my best to be polite.
Before I go any further, it's just such an honor to have you here in my incredible studio.
Thank you very much.
Yes, in the beautiful Hollywood
Hills. Peak of luxury. Yes.
This is, I mean, you walking through my courtyard might have been the funniest thing I've ever seen.
Well, it's the finest studio I've ever seen in my life.
But it's such an honor because I know your history, and because this is such a full album, I just want to dive right into it. So I want you to tell me, when did you first meet George Harrison?
Well, I'm not very good at dates, but I imagine it would have been around end of 63, I suppose. I mean, I first met the Beatles when they first came down to London, whenever that was, you know. I never knew them in Liverpool. One of the weirdest things about, you know, when I became part of the so-called British invasion and was over here myself, everyone assumed that we were from Liverpool. And even when we convinced them we weren't from Liverpool, they assumed we knew Liverpool really
well.
So
you got that Liverpool vibe, bro.
I don't. I definitely don't. I don't have the accent. I don't have the vibe. And they'd go, oh, but, you know, isn't Liverpool, what's Liverpool like? And I was going, we've never been there. They went, that's impossible. I went, no. Everyone I know in Liverpool, the minute they can afford a train ticket, they're in London. So nobody in their right mind went there on purpose, you know? So, and the Beatles, of course, got out of there as soon as they could.
So what was
now?
Your,
it's become legendary.
But what was your first experience with? So it's just them just jamming, and you're seeing the band develop, or at that point they're already really
no. They you know, I met them shortly after my sister met them, and she met them because she was invited to go and see their first London gig. You know, I guess Love Me Do was out, the first single, and they, you know, Beatlemania was setting in, at least in the UK. Of course, the US didn't catch it for a year or so. And so she was invited by a magazine called the Radio Times, which is kind of like TV Guide, only, you know, we didn't really need a TV Guide because we only had one channel, and the BBC. And so anyway, she was invited to go and see them and write a piece about the Beatles, because her opinion about music was practiced. And she was a very well-known actress, still is, and she was always, it was kind of a guest celebrity review, and that's how she met them, and so on, and then she and Paul started going out together. So I met them all, and eventually, as you probably know, Paul ended up living in our house for a couple of years. And
was he a good flatmate? Did he like drink your milk ever?
I get asked that all the time.
Did he buy paper towels? That's what I would. Did Paul?
Sorry, I didn't mean to use the less of the paper. Did paper towels exist in 1968? I don't think they did. I don't think they did. I think we had to actually use real towels and wash them. Like,
Paul, can you start chipping in on the cable bill? Can you start? I don't know why we have Cinemax.
We definitely didn't have cable. I can tell you that. None of the things you mentioned. You're forgetting how old we all are.
I'm in an alternate world, bro.
Exactly.
But all right, but let's
no
get it.
No paper towels, no
so,
cable,
but,
for
so,
sure.
But your sister, so Paul's living with your family.
Yes.
But let's be specific to George. Like, what was your first thoughts on George?
When I was
you
getting
met
there.
Him?
You asked me when I first met George. It's quite all right. No.
Stop screaming at me.
It's your job. So soon I met all the Beatles, and I think first time I met them, I seem to recall it was in a pub somewhere, but I'm not quite sure why or when, but I do remember that they were all there with wives and girlfriends at the time, which would have been Maureen and Cynthia, and so on. And Yeah, I distinctly remember being in a pub and all drinking pints of beer, but I can't remember where or exactly why it ended up being on that occasion. But I guess Paul had invited me to come with him or whatever, and that, I think that's the first time I met them all.
And George, like, what were your first thoughts on him meeting him for the first time?
Well, you know, those Beatle descriptions, like most cliches, they're pretty much right on.
He was really?
he was the quiet one.
Yeah.
So I didn't have a distinct impression of him. John was, you know, more present in the conversation, and John was somebody who tended to be a bit argumentative, and George was someone who tended not to say a whole lot, and Ringo tended to be funny. So the cliches were correct. So I don't have, you know, I never knew George particularly well. I knew him and liked him, and obviously we worked together when I was head of A&R at Apple. You know, we were in a lot of meetings together and did stuff together, but he was, you know, which I regret because I liked him very much, but I certainly wouldn't pretend that he and I were close friends.
We're close friends, but you know,
whereas other friends of mine, people like Eric Idle, who is one of my best friends, was best friends with George. So
yeah,
there's a lot of connections there. But did George and I actually hang out talking about the meaning of life? No.
So the Beatles, of course, become the Beatles, the biggest band in the world, and then there's the breakup. So do you remember kind of like what was going on in your life when All Things Must Pass came out? So it came out, it was released November 27th, 1970. It's 433 out of 500, and it was produced by George Harrison. Do you remember kind of what was going on? I mean, were you still connected to Apple at that time?
No.
So,
and I don't know, as I say, the actual dates, but certainly, you know, when Alan Klein moved into Apple, or it became clear that he was going to,
yeah,
when Alan Klein won the argument that Paul lost, you know, that because John got George and Ringo on his side, that they should bring in this guy, Alan Klein. Paul was vigorously opposed. I was on Paul's side. I knew about Alan Klein from friends in New York. He was essentially a crook. And a skilled crook, you know, but not somebody I'd want in charge of my record label or my band. And Paul felt very strongly that way. So once I knew Alan was coming in, I wrote a letter of resignation to Apple.
Yeah.
And got out of there and took James with me. I bet my career on his. I became James's manager. I was already producing his records.
Yeah.
We'd made that one album, the James Taylor album, for Apple. So I moved to Los Angeles and
immediately started stripping, right? Because that's what we have to do when... Okay, never mind.
That's quite right. No. I will indulge these moments.
Thank you.
But yeah, I mean, and I did see George since then. I remember distinctly hanging out with George when he had the house on Blue Jay Way. I don't remember what era that particular
But
I remember I was in that house. Yeah. And I remember going with George to a party at one of the Monkees' house, which I read another account of this particular party
in
somebody's
that?
Book, where everybody was naked.
We've all been to that party at the Monkees' house.
And I remember George, we decided not to get naked. It was George and myself and a couple other people, I can't remember who. And we ended up, Stephen Stills was there playing guitar brilliantly, naked, but brilliant guitar playing. I'm a huge Stephen fan. And it's a rather hazy memory for whatever reason.
What I was told...
These were the 70s in Los Angeles.
What I was told was that Davy Jones saw his penis and went, oh, when I see his penis, but I'm a believer. I had to.
Of course.
I'm so sorry.
I understand. It's a compulsion.
All right, but let's take it to this. So for me, as a huge, huge Beatles fan, you know, it's so funny because growing up, I always thought John Lennon was my favorite Beatle. He was like, he's the coolest guy. He's the guy that wrote Happiness is a Warm Gun and all of these incredible songs. And as I've gotten older, I've just fallen so in love with George Harrison.
Yeah, no, he's brilliant. I mean, that's the thing about the Beatles is that you can look at each of them and realize how singularly important they are on their own.
Yes.
So in each case, you know, one of the reasons the Beatles were so colossally important and remain so to this day is that it is like a perfect storm where these four very different people, musically different, emotionally different, you know,
existentially different,
temperamentally
like,
different,
yeah.
and yet they fitted together perfectly. It's as if, you know, in the same way, to take a completely opposite extreme, the way they cast the Spice Girls, you know, when it was, okay, we're going to have the posh one, we're going to have this one, we're going to have the funny one. What were the other ones called? I can't even remember now.
The baby one,
anyway,
the heroin addict.
But it's as if, you know, some supreme being had decided to cast the perfect band. You know, we'll have these four people with these four sets of characteristics, these four different kinds of looks, and these four different musical talents, and put them all together and create the greatest band of all time.
Oh,
and that's what happened.
We got into an argument. I was doing another episode and somebody said that the Beatles were a boy band, and I just was like, this is like, boy bands are formulaic. Like you have these guys that are like, I'm gonna get the cute one and this one. This was just the universe blessing.
It was a boy band created by the universe.
Of course.
Rather than created by
I said they were a band of boys more than they were a boy band.
Who was the fat guy who went to prison? Who created
Ron? I was gonna say Ron Perlman, but it's Perlman. It's
Lou Perlman.
Perlman. Yeah.
Ron
Perlman's
story.
Hellboy.
Same
thing.
I mean, that's
same moniker.
That was a terrible story, and that's boy band phenomenon at its worst.
At its worst, but.
And luckily, that was not in any way what the Beatles
at
were.
At all.
And they created themselves, of course. They found each other.
For sure.
You know, you can see the hand of the fate in the fact that that happened.
Yeah.
But they found each other and met each other and knew, you know, this is the right guy. They all talk about that. You know, when John and Paul first met, you know, when they first played with George, and finally when Ringo first, they changed drummers and Ringo sat in, they all kind of went, now we're ready. You know, there was this feeling of like the four pieces of the jigsaw have just clicked together and we're off.
Oh, that's so great.
And that's what happened. And they've talked about that feeling, you know, and they had there was no question in their minds that the minute those four people first got in the room and played together, it was like, here we go.
So, but then when it comes to the ending of the Beatles, I mean, how connected were you with them as the Beatles were starting to go their separate ways, having these arguments, you know?
I mean, reasonably so, because obviously during that period when I was at Apple and they were there all the time, there were massive rows going on, because that was the time they always had rows. Bands all have rows. Any band, you should assume they basically kind of hate each other.
You spend that much time together in a truck.
Found a way to live together. You either find a way to make it work. You know, Mick and Keith, in some senses, they no doubt still hate each other, but at the same time, they've totally negotiated, found, discovered by experience how they work together best.
Did you?
And they know they need each other. That worked, you know, overcame most of the trivial arguments that they would have until this whole Alan Klein business, you know, around which all the minor things coalesced, and that became the big argument.
Sure. Did you start seeing like these signs of greatness from George, like, and was he being pushed around or pushed down by Paul and John? Because these are all songs off of All Things Must Pass that he was writing and getting together throughout the Let It Be sessions.
He felt that way, certainly. I mean, there was a sense in which it was how many songs George could have on an album felt rationed. There's no question.
Yeah.
But on the other hand, you could look at it, the fact that without that, would George have got as brilliant as he did?
No, I think
his desperate ambition to show them, I'll show them in the literal sense, you know, screw them, I'll show them I can write great songs. And the only way to do that is to bloody write them.
Yeah.
And he did.
I mean, to be the first Beatle to drop a solo record, you know, it's just... And I've listened to a lot of the Beatles solo records, and I have to tell you, and out of all the albums I've done on this list so far, I've never felt a record that is so full of love. It's like, you can't listen to this and not have a very grateful experience. I was listening to Isn't It a Pity, version 2, the acoustic one last night, and I started weeping. It was like, I just felt, you know, friends of mine that love music that have passed away just in the room with me while I was listening to it, and it was... It's just, you know, every artist puts their heart into the music, but on this album, not only do you feel it, but you see it, and you can know, you feel like you know a part of George as you listen to it. It's a brilliant, brilliant record.
I agree. No, it's an amazing record. I mean, I remember it was one of those records where the first time you hear it,
yes,
however much you already admired George, you realized it was an underestimate.
Yeah.
Even if you realized already his skill as a guitar player, his excellence as a writer and singing and all that stuff. And his singing got better, his range increased, everything improved, you know, and maybe that's, some of that was a desperate effort to gain equality in what he saw as an unequal relationship.
Sure.
But it worked.
It did work. I got this quote before we dive into the first song. I saw a critic say this: a major talent unleashed, one who'd been hidden in plain sight for all those years. And it's so true. It's like you see George starting to shine towards the end of the Beatles catalog, but nothing. Like, I'll put any of these songs on this record up there with Here Comes the Sun or something.
Yeah.
But let's dive into the record. Okay, so it opens with I'd Have You Anytime. So in 1968, after completing work on the Beatles' White Album, George came to America for a couple months. And while here, he co-wrote this song of love with Bob Dylan, who came up with him in the chorus, and Eric Clapton on lead guitar. Peter, play the intro. Kind of a slow opening for such a powerful record. And my thoughts on this, maybe I'm wrong, Peter, but maybe he didn't want to, maybe he didn't want to like rush us into some of the rock songs. He wanted to ease us into his world, like an old man getting into a bath, you know, and not even an old man getting into a bath, a man of any age getting into a bath. I slipped getting into the bath a couple weeks ago and got a concussion on that soap thing that's on the wall. So I love this song.
I've never associated it with bathtubs before,
but you know
it's a way of looking at things. Yeah, I mean, well, you're looking, don't forget, making the album and sequencing the album are usually two very different operations. I mean, occasionally you end up in the studio making a track and go, oh, this would be great to open side two or something, which of course is an antiquated concept. But generally, you're just making this each song as good as you can be, as good as it can be. And the sequencing thing tends to happen at the end, you know, when you pretty much got everything done and mixed, then you actually, you know, sometimes put strips of paper up on a whiteboard in order and just try all the different sequences and listen to them, you know. So I don't know why they chose to put that first. You may be right, but it's not, that wouldn't be why the song exists, but it could be why it ended up in first place, because as I say, sequencing back then was a very important operation. Now it's absolutely meaningless.
Oh, nobody writes albums anymore. Now what they do is they just write singles and with iTunes and Spotify.
Which is fine. Yeah. But if you do write an album, you're welcome to. But of course, people will write their own. That's my point. You know,
sure.
Even if you said, "Here's the order of the songs," they'd go, "No, it isn't." Of course, you've got infinity of time.
Oh, trust me, there's so.
But
much
you've also got, you know, if you wanted only 3 minutes, put out a great 3 minutes, you're home.
Oh, 100%.
So I love that myself.
But meanwhile, while this is going on, you're in England, where after your hit musical duo Peter and Gordon broke up, you became the head of A&R at Beatles record label Apple, like we talked about.
Yeah.
That same year, you discovered and produced the first American signed artist, James Taylor.
First signed artist at all.
At all.
Yeah.
Which is great.
Yeah.
There you go, America. USA, breaking in. All right. The next one on this record is the one that stuck out to me immediately years ago. It's My Sweet Lord, the first single from the album and the first Beatles solo to go number one. It was originally written in 1969 while George was playing shows with rock and soul group Delaney and Bob and Friends, and whose keyboardist was later Beatles contributor Billy Preston. Peter, play 308. The only way to describe this song is breathtaking. Like this, this song makes me want to cut my hair, except for like a long ponytail, put on an off orange robe, give up all my worldly possessions, and hand out pamphlets at the airport. That's what I feel when I hear this.
You'd become even more annoying than you've managed so far. It's the perfect job for you.
Ooh, sweet burn. Sweet burn. George was trying to write a gospel song like the Edwins Hawkins Singers'
Oh Happy Day.
Yes.
Yep.
But using the repeated mantras of his Hare Krishna faith. However, though, and you probably know this, the copyright holders of the Chiffons' 1963 hit,
of course,
He's So Fine, sued over similarities. Peter, play a little bit of He's So Fine.
He's so fine.
So the lawsuit went on for years until 76 when George was eventually found guilty of subconscious plagiarism. What a weird
judge decree.
Well, it means that, you know, that you remember it, but you weren't consciously copying it. But you must. I mean, there's no question he heard the record and liked it.
As a comic, that's happened to me. It's just like you hear so many jokes, and then next thing you know, you write a premise, and somebody's like, "Well, what was that?"
Exactly. Well, comics think they all steal from each other all the time, 100%. And they do.
Yeah, we do. We all steal. I'm stealing from your wallet right now. I'm just taking pounds out. He was ordered to pay a huge sum. Even then, the case wasn't completely settled until 1993. I just got to ask this. Have you ever talked to George about that lawsuit and his feelings about it?
No, I have not. I mean, I like both records. There is a similarity. There's no question. But this whole business, you know, it continues to this day. It goes on all the time, and it gets very weird. I mean, there was the whole Robin Thicke.
Got to give it up from Marvin Gaye.
From Marvin Gaye, and they talked about in public how they took the groove from this Marvin Gaye record they all loved, you know, because they thought it was so cool, and it was meant as like an homage to the genius of Marvin Gaye. And suddenly they went, give us tons of money, and they lost that one, and Ed Sheeran's got a couple going on, and it's become all the rage. Of course, people do copy subconsciously and consciously, you know. As for my atheist self, I think "Do Lang" is a better lyric than Hare Krishna, but that's just me.
I love that. All right,
I joined the "Do Lang" cult. I'm not sure what kind of robes we
just
wear,
we just hang out at a Ralph's supermarket and just help people bag their
and tell
groceries.
Them we don't believe in anything. Yeah. And, you know. Robes optional.
All right. Next one is Wawa. This was the first song recorded for this album. My favorite thing about this song is how it just keeps building. So, Peter, play it 422 when it's at full capacity. So this is named after the guitar effect foot pedal, but in this song, it means headache. So legend has it that George wrote this after walking out of the Let It Be sessions. He was feeling undervalued and pushed around by Paul, which you can actually see in the Beatles anthologies. There's that famous scene where George is sitting there like, I don't have to play. I'll play whatever you want me to play. And it's so... like you just blow it off while you're seeing it there, and now years later, especially after hearing this, it's like, wow, how much weight was on that.
Yeah, we're gonna learn a lot when the Peter Jackson new version is, you know.
Ooh.
You know, Peter Jackson's directing the new Let It Be, and he's got huge amounts of amazing footage.
Oh, I can't wait for that. I had no idea about that. But let me
ask. Oh yeah, no, it's a big thing, and he's devoted the next couple of years to it. And then there's 10 or 15 minutes that you know, there's some bits that people have actually seen, and it's colossally good, and it gives you a whole other impression of
it. It's going to be weird when, and then you're like, why are the Beatles performing in Mordor? Thank you. I got a giggle out of you. That's all I care about.
So I told you I'm very polite.
So the Beatles had this toxic work environment that led to him temporarily quitting in January of 69. Were you ever present for one of the really bad fights between the Beatles?
Not quite. No, but we were aware of them. I mean, there were times when there was one particular occasion when there was some big meeting going on that Neil Aspinall and Peter Brown and stuff we were in. I was in the beginning of it, and then I left. But eventually, the four Beatles wanted to be alone in the meeting room. We did hear massively raised voices and yelling, and it was actually George who came storming out first, slamming the door. So, yeah, things were intense.
Any idea of what they were fighting over?
Not at all.
Not at all?
And I don't think it really matters. You know, we all know that later on, you know, after the divorce or the band breakup or whatever the hell's going on, we say, well, what exactly were you arguing about? Usually people go, I don't precisely remember, you know, but
yeah.
The point is you grab onto something and make that, you know, why the other person's a completely blithering idiot and, you know, you despise them. And once you get to that stage, you know, the marriage or the band is over.
100%. And that kind of leads us into the next track, which is properly titled "Isn't It a Pity," version one. Peter, play 302. How we take each other's love without thinking anymore. This has a real Beatles feel to it, you know?
It does.
It has the Lennon descending piano, and it also has this big Paul McCartney, Hey Jude type ending that just keeps going and going. And it's like, I didn't want this song to end. I love this version.
And a lot of cool slide guitar in there, too.
Very cool
slide
guitar.
I mean, George became a master of the slide guitar. He discovered it, I think, quite late on.
We were just listening to the last record we just did was Big Star, number one record. Uh-huh. And there's, like, a couple songs in there that you're like, oh, they're biting off George's slide. Oh, like, right. I feel it. Because they were so in love with the Beatles, Chris Bell and Alex Chilton. Now, according to George, this song is just an observation of how society and myself were or are. We take each other for granted and forget to give back. This song just gets me in the squiggles every time. Also, there's 17 more versions of this song on the record, so we're going to skip 14 of them.
Okay.
And bring us to the next one, What Is Life? Most people might remember this next one being played during Ray Liotta's paranoid cocaine meatball making FBI surveillancing scene in Goodfellas. Kick it, Peter! Makes you want to just snort an eight ball and make
Well, it does. There's something about fuzz tone guitars and cocaine that go very well together. I'm guessing.
Put some coke up my nose and make some manicotti. That's all I feel like doing. Yep. This was the second single.
You wouldn't eat the manicotti.
No, you couldn't. We're high on coke.
We'd make it full of energy.
Yeah. We'd be trying to start a business together talking about RoboCop. That's what we'd be doing.
Right,
so this was the second single, and it was a top 10 hit all over the world. This was written quickly in 69 during the Beatles' Abbey Road album period for Billy Preston's album, That's the Way God Planned It, that George was co-producing, but then he decided he wanted to hold on to it.
I remember when George was doing that album, so maybe I was there then. I don't know, it gets confusing. I do remember when George was producing that, yes.
Okay, well, here's the thing. Either this song is about a woman or God or maybe both. Any idea?
No.
Perfect.
Sorry, I never try to guess what lyrics are about. If you do guess, you're usually wrong. Unless it happens to be something where the songwriter did actually tell me. But I usually don't ask, because the answer is usually astonishing. You know, sometimes it's not what you think at all. You know, with some songwriters, it's about a number of things at the same time. I mean, with some of the most brilliant songwriters, Joni Mitchell, you know, I've in the past talked to her about what certain songs are about, and the explanation can be like hours and hours, you know, a long night explaining one song, because this line was about this person she met and this thing that happened, but the other line's about somebody. So
yeah,
it's not even a consistent single meaning song, and you know, which is one of the reasons she's such a genius. So yeah, it can be surprising.
It can be surprising.
Carla Bonoff wrote a song called Goodbye Old Friend, I think, or something like that, a beautiful song, and it became a song that was played a lot at funerals, and especially for some reason it caught on in during the ghastly HIV AIDS epidemic, when a lot of people were dying. There were funerals all the time, and it was the song people used all the time. And there was a point where she was kind of thinking, I better not tell anyone that it was about my cat dying. Because
she's like, this one's about Mookie. Mookie died. Mr. Flufflesworth.
It didn't make the song any less meaningful.
Yeah.
But she suddenly realized, well, that, you know, then people might go, oh, well, that's weird, you know.
Yeah. Oh, I love that.
And you know, so sometimes the meaning of a song changes, and that's why, you know, the meaning of the song when sung at those funerals was a whole other meaning, and a very profound and extremely serious one. And that happens with songs, that the meaning's changed by what the singer means, and also by what the listener hears and imagines when they listen to it.
You know?
So I'm always reluctant to talk about the meaning of songs, because who knows, you know? And some songwriters have said that same thing. Well, I thought it was about this, but now I'm learning from the listening public it's actually about that, you know? And that maybe is more important and better.
That's what I love about George's songs, is that you don't have to know. You just feel it. And that's all that matters.
Right, and my point is sometimes it's better not to know. Or if you think you know, then you're right.
Yeah.
You know, so this is what the song means. Okay, you know, good.
All right. The next one's It's Not For You. I love this song.
Me too.
But since it was a Bob Dylan cover, we are skipping it.
Okay.
Because that then brings us to Behind That Locked Door, just a very pretty country waltz.
Which I don't remember at all at the moment.
We're about to play it, but hold on, Peter. It's got a little touch of Hawaii. Okay. Makaleke Huki playing Peter. Play playing the pedal steel was who?
Pete Drake.
Pete Drake. It's incredible. That
he's famous. Absolutely. One of the best. So, Nashville-based, brilliant steel player.
Well, I'm finding out about him.
He's the man. One of the men. See, pedal steel is an instrument that is very specific. Yeah. It's also one of the only instruments. This is digression, but I always digress. It's the only instrument, one of the only instruments, I think, where they can never play each other's. In other words, if a pedal steel player walks in the room and someone says, "Oh, you can use mine." No, you can't. Because the way you set up the pedals on the floor and the levers you work with your knees is done however you want it. In other words, you set it up yourself. It takes these strings up a half step, takes these strings down, whatever it does is different in every case.
Yeah.
So it's not like a piano or a guitar where you can pick someone else's up and play.
For sure.
It's a very idiosyncratic and particular and eccentric instrument and very beautiful. I used pedal steel a lot on a lot of the Linda Ronstadt records I did, and I love it.
What I think just takes this just simple song and just puts so much depth to it.
Yeah, and it is more country than Hawaii.
But you can hear
that. Hawaii's more lap steel.
For sure. But you can hear why I would say that.
Oh, yes,
it does have that. Does have that vibe. Now, this song was written in 69 as a note of encouragement. I love this story so much. It was written as a note of encouragement for Bob Dylan, who was about to make a comeback at the Isle of Wight Festival after 3 years in almost total seclusion with his family.
That was after the motorcycle crash or something, right? Was that it? That period? I think maybe.
I think so.
I think it
was.
Yeah, and then they went to the Isle of Wight Festival. Some Beatles went, didn't they?
Yeah, I think George definitely did because, I think he probably was like, had to be there to support his buddy.
Yeah, I think a couple of them went, and it was supposed to be the classic Isle of Wight Festival. People still talk about that one being the greatest.
Oh, God.
I never went to the Isle of Wight myself at all.
Really? You were a Lollapalooza guy, weren't you?
No, I was.
He's like, whatever. He's like, I'm a big Ozfest fan.
No, I went to Woodstock
and the Gathering of the Juggalos.
I was at Woodstock.
Were you?
Yeah, but I haven't been to. Haven't been to Ozfest, I must admit.
You're not missing anything, bro.
Well, I like Sharon.
All right, moving on. Let It Down. George wrote this in 68 and tried to get it on Let It Be, but again was turned down, which is fucked because this song bangs with a side of Girl, Let Me Touch Your Booty. Play the chorus. Let it down. I know we played the chorus, but this is actually a very sensual, sexual love and lust song. I mean, just going by some of these lyrics, let it down, let your hair hang all around me, let it down, let your love flow and astound me. And I love so much the quiet verse into the pounding chorus. I mean, I hate to say it's so like you could see like how Nirvana copied this. We just did in Euro, and it's just incredible. And it's such a sensual song for someone like George, who, you like we said, is the quiet one and seemed kind of inhibited, I guess, you know, just on the surface at least.
Yeah, I wouldn't know, but it's a good song.
It's a great song. There's been a lot of talk about George's marriage and relationship with Patty Boyd and how she ended up with his best friend Eric Clapton. But also, and we did a little bit of research, Morty found out George was no angel and had many affairs, including some with exes of Eric as well.
Well, what do you know?
What do you
know? Rock and roll bands have affairs with other women than their wives. It's a shocking revelation.
Shocking!
Oh. This will change the music business forever.
How
no,
spookle.
I mean, if you're a Beatle, you know, what are you going to do?
You kind of just, you know.
You can't turn them all away.
Oh,
you know?
God, no. I can imagine. Good God.
You're young, you're a Beatle. You know, it's what you do.
It is what you do. All right, Run of the Mill. This one was inspired by the band and written after the bummed out Get Back sessions. It reflected George's unhappiness with how Running Apple Records put a strain on their friendships and partnerships, especially with Paul.
Let me interrupt with one thing. It wasn't just Apple Records. It was actually when Apple went beyond records. I occasionally speak in defense of Apple Records because Apple Records did at least have some success. You know, James Taylor, Mary Hopkin, Jackie Lomax, the Ivies, who became Badfinger. We sold some records, had some hits. Because the Beatles knew what they were doing. You know, I would have A&R meetings once a week with as many Beatles as showed up, and they knew what they were talking about. When they got into movies, let alone clothing and electronics and all that other stuff, that's when things started to really get bizarre.
Because,
you know, they didn't know what they were doing. Yeah. And Magic Alex was, you know, a fraud, and things just got downright dicey. And it was all of that that made them think they needed an Alan Klein type figure to come in and be rough and tough and sort it all out.
But you also had some unhappiness at Apple Records. And like you said, you left to come to America to manage and continue to produce. James, after his Apple debut, didn't find an audience. Were you supported in your decision, or was there hard feelings?
Didn't seem to be any hard feelings, because Paul and I remained friends. I saw less of the other Beatles after that time. These days I see more Ringo than any of the others, because he's here, you know. But no, there did not appear to be any hard feelings. And there were no, you know, despite the fact that James was theoretically still under contract to this label that was in chaos and in legal straits, we never got sued or anything. And I've read that was actually thanks to George, that he was one of the people saying to Alan Klein, no, whatever else happens, that's the kind of label we said we would never be, you know. If we didn't get the job done and the artist has left, so be it.
Yeah.
So if that's true, I owe George a great debt of gratitude. And I've read that it was primarily him who said that.
No, I believe it. A very spiritual guy.
Yeah.
You know, very, you know, sees things pragmatically. That leads us to our next song, Beware of Darkness.
Which is a great song. I think this may be my favorite song of the
Really?
Album. Yeah, I like this song a lot.
Play the first verse.
It's very good. Watch out now. Take a new word. Curious chord changes that are really excellent.
This song was influenced by the teachings of the Radha Krishna Temple. Its advice is stay away from illusions, material things, corrupting influencers, which I understand because social media influencers, I hate all of you, and negative thoughts on the way to spiritual enlightenment and the true purpose of light. Peter, I'm just going to let you know right now, I am enlightened, even though you probably don't think so.
No, I'm sure you are.
I am.
I've managed to avoid it so far myself.
You don't see my aura glow?
I'm not good at
wavelengths?
I'm not good at auras. No.
Just go ahead. Feel the aura, bro.
I'll take your aura. What color is your aura?
It's, you know, it's like a teal. Okay. I'm a teal, like a Charlotte Hornet teal.
There you go.
Let me ask you this. How have you stayed positive about music after all these years, and what currently excites you about it?
Oh, discovering new people who are great, and there's so many of them, you know. I vigorously reject the, you know, oh, they don't write music as good as they did back in our day, you know, all that crap that I hear all the time. As I go out and do shows, you know, which I do a lot of, and talk to I hear that from the audience a lot, and I keep having to explain, listen, you know, this is selective memory. You're remembering all the great music from the 60s, you know. There was tons of really crappy music. And we swept that away. We don't remember it, you know.
Yeah.
And it's the same now, you know. We will remember, you know, Ed Sheeran. We will remember Billie Eilish. We won't remember all the stuff that, you know, is should be forgotten.
I hate to say it, dude, but Lil Uzi Vert is engraved in my brain, unfortunately.
Which one?
Lil Uzi.
Oh, yeah.
You don't know Lil Uzi?
I don't think I do.
You should book a dual headlining
tour. I've seen the name, but
with
no,
James Taylor, Lil Uzi Vert, throw Migos in there, and then have Linda Ronstadt come out and do a duet with all three of them. That would be the shit, bro.
Yeah, that would be great. I'm in.
All right. Apple Scruffs.
Yeah.
Which I think I need medication for. George hated fan worship. But like the other Beatles, he had a soft spot for the hardcore, longtime Beatles fans who basically lived outside of their studios and offices well past Beatlemania.
You know, they were nice. They knew everybody by name. They knew the whole staff of the building, you know. And George liked them. He named them the Apple Scruffs.
Yeah, I mean, dude, not only did he name them the Apple Scruffs, which, by the way, sounds like a diss from the movie The Sandlot. I don't know if you've ever seen that, where he's like, you cake-eating Apple Scruff.
Oh.
That's all I heard. But this is a beautiful Bob Dylan-inspired tribute song.
Yes.
So you were talking about the relationship. We don't need to play the track, but what was your relationship with the Apple Scruffs? I mean, did you have any interaction? You said they seemed nice.
Yeah, I mean, if they were there when you arrived at work, you'd say good morning, and you'd say goodbye when you left. I mean, they were just a fixture of the doorstep. They were there a lot.
Were you stepping over them? Like,
no, they were just milling about, you know. There weren't that many
smoking
of them.
Pot or just hanging?
No, just hanging, talking. Yeah, I mean, they obviously came and went, but there were usually a few of them floating about, and they were nice. And one of them's around. I got an email or letter or something from her the other day saying, you know, you wouldn't remember me, but I was a scruff. They were nice.
I was
fans
I
usually
was,
are. You know,
I was
especially,
the
especially when they're on their own. It was when they got into this crowd mania thing.
Yeah.
As you know, in large groups, the weird things happen to people, and so that the crazy stuff when they'd be, you know, rocking the limo and rushing the door.
Be, yeah.
That was peculiar, and there is something that happens, you know, when they get into a large group. It's, you know, that whole Beatlemania, which all of us, of course, experienced to a much lesser degree, but once the Beatles established the template, the this is how it's done, you know, all of us were part of the British Invasion. Every concert was screaming from beginning to end. They chased you, but if they caught you, they didn't know what to do. I mean, it was
started
just
tickling you.
Well, it was. I'll tell you the.
I can imagine you giggling, being tickled by a scruff.
Here's the most psychologically interesting moment I remember. Because the other thing was the police at all these gigs would always go, "Don't worry, we can handle it. It's fine. We've done this before. It's just a few girls, nothing to worry about."
Yeah.
And they immediately get overcome by these hordes of crazed women, and you just knock the police out of the way. We did a gig once, an outdoor gig. We were playing on this little outdoor stage in sort of the corner of a baseball field. And again, the police said, "Oh, don't worry, you know." And they said, "No, these British acts, things get pretty unruly." But anyway, so we started playing. These screaming girls all broke through the little police cordon with no trouble whatsoever, and they were all charging across the baseball field, which was upsetting everybody because it was going to damage the precious turf or whatever, and towards the stage. And so the police came and said, "You have to get off the stage, run for the dressing room." So I get off, I jump off the stage. As I jump, my glasses fall down on the ground. So I reach down, pick them up, and carry on running. I look back. The lead girl in this maniacal pack of women is stopped where my glasses fell and is pulling the grass up from the ground where they fell and eating it.
Oh my God.
And I went, "That's cool." I mean, this one is speechless. What does that mean? You know?
All right. Ballad of Sir Frankie Crisp, Let It Roll, which I think is my new favorite song on this album. Because of this section we're about to play 211. So this was dedicated to the eccentric 19th century lawyer and original owner of Friar Park, the sprawling and unique mansion that George bought, renovated, and moved into in 1970. And it's essentially a travelogue through the property. I just think this song is so beautiful.
Yeah, as is the house.
Yeah. Really? You've been there?
Oh, yeah, many times.
Really?
Yeah.
You ever done some coke and made manicotti there?
That was
little squiggly Dan?
No, I've been there a couple of times back in the day and to visit Olivia more recently.
Oh, that's great. All right, well, let's speak.
It's an amazing house. And now it's just, you know, when he bought it, it was a wreck, but she's made it perfect. Olivia's done an incredible job.
I want to ask you a question. Speaking of eccentric and fascinating people like Sir Frankie Crisp, in the early 2000s, you produced a live record for probably one of the greatest comedic minds of all time, Robin Williams.
Yes.
How did that come about, and what was that like?
Robin and I were great friends. My wife actually knew Robin before I did, and he and I hit it off and became very close friends, and so when he was doing this album, he asked me if I would like to help him with it. So I basically consisted of, you know, spending 3 weeks on the road and making notes of every night, you know, which bits worked well particular nights and what things I thought could be tightened up or changed. And Robin and his manager and I and his wife Marcia at the time, and would talk about, you know, what we might try differently in the shows themselves. But in the meantime, I was accumulating this treasure trove of all the great bits on tape, as it were. I use the word tape metaphorically.
I still say tape. Keep saying tape.
Exactly.
Don't let that die.
Exactly. And so that's what it was. And then I spent quite a while, you know, working on it. And Robin liked the result. So yeah, that was when we won the Grammy for Comedy Album of the Year, not a Grammy I've expected to have in my collection, which was very exciting.
That is so cool. That is so cool. All right, moving on to the next song that makes me so happy, Awaiting on You All. Peter, play the first verse. Don't need a love list. Don't need a best plan. You don't need a heart as you're for the right. Unless you're in. You open up your heart. This is just a joyful, reverb-drenched gospel song about chanting your chosen spiritual God's name to cleanse your soul independent of organized Western religion. And this is what makes the song cool and George cool. If you think George is being all peace and love on this, listen to the lyrics on parts of the last verse and chorus, because he takes aim at Catholicism, which George was raised in, and its ties to materialism. All right, so these are the lyrics I pulled. You don't need no church house. You don't need no temple. You don't need no rosary beads or them books to read to see that you have fallen. And then this is the real squiggly diggly. He says, and while the Pope owns 51% of General Motors and the stock exchange is the only thing he's qualified to quote us, shots fired from the nice Beetle.
Yes, indeed. Yeah.
Any thoughts on that?
It's a good lyric. I think it's terrific, and I agree with every word of it.
Yeah. All right. Moving on. To All Things Must Pass. Peter, play minute 30. It's not always gonna be this great. All things must pass. This one gets me in my chunk chunks. So this was inspired by The Wait by the band. It was originally demoed in 69 on the same day as Something, and it addresses the themes of the mortality of everything. Many Beatles fans took this to be advice for dealing with their breakup. And like you said earlier, you know, and we said actually, is that, you know, any of these can be interpreted as life, death, love, whatever. But, and that's why I think I love this song so much, because it could be about.
It can. I mean, from a scientific point of view, it's a celebration of entropy. You know, all things will pass.
I said this could be about the food you've eaten. You know what I mean? All things will pass.
That's true, too.
In retrospect, all the fans know the retold stories of when each Beatle wanted to leave the band. But when did you first know that the dream was over?
I think it was very gradual. I mean, I do remember Paul telling me of the time that Ringo said he didn't want to be in the band anymore. And I think that might have been the first time.
That was around the Maharishi time, right? Because that's at least what I saw in the anthology.
It could be.
Anthology.
Yeah, I'm not too good at remembering dates or chronology. But it was a time when I think Paul and John were arguing a lot. And the last thing they expected was for Ringo
to be the one, yeah.
Just kind of go, you know what? I don't think I want to be in this band anymore. It's no fun, kind of thing. And I think that brought them up short in a big way, and probably put off the breakup of the Beatles for a bit, you know, because they went, well, that's not good. If we made it no fun for Ringo, then what's the point?
Yeah.
You know? But I think, as you know, I believe it was John who finally said, you know, I'm definitely quitting the band. Goodbye.
Next song, I Dig Love. This John Lennon-esque song started as an exercise for George to practice his slide guitar technique, and it sounds that way until the chorus. Peter, play 114. What's funny about this song is this is just straight up lustful. It's another one of those songs that you don't expect out of George. And it kind of does make sense, because in the early 60s, the Beatles were these wild punk kids in Hamburg, Germany. George, of course, was the youngest. And then they become these huge stars and got all married up. And then they stopped touring. So while everyone was looking at George like he was this abstinent Eastern swami on a hill, like, he was going on the road with Delaney and Bonnie and friends, and he took full advantage of that groupy sloopy.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? So
I have some idea of what you mean, yes.
Groupy sloopy?
I was on the road a lot myself in the 60s.
Really? Yeah. Do you get a little bit of that groupy sloopy?
It seems possible.
Ooh, shuggy-duggy, quack-quack. All right. I'm just saying gibberish at this point. All right, Art of Dying, play a minute 37. I love this song. This song doesn't, I don't know if it really, I'm not going to say it does or does not fit with this record, but after I found out this, it kind of made sense that Lennon and Harrison were dosed by LSD by their dentist in Los Angeles in February of 65, And that was a big change that happened to their outlooks and to their songwriting. I feel like a little bit of this is from that. But this song is about trying to die correctly to move on to the next plane of existence and avoid being reincarnated as another earthbound creature.
Yeah.
Now we've come to a song that I was listening to last night. It just crushed me. Isn't it a pity? Version 2, just a slower, shorter, and more intimate version than the first one, and removes most of the overt Beatle musical styles. It also has probably one of my favorite parts on the entire record. Peter, play 215. That movement, and just even the way his voice sounds, it just has a different feel that I feel, you know, like I said, I lost my best friend. That's the reason that I'm doing this podcast. And when I was listening to this last night, he was in the room with me. It was like, mm-hmm. I felt it. It was palpable. Now I want to ask you this. When did you first make a conscious effort to step out of the shadow of the Beatles?
I didn't really think of it in that way. I mean, I suppose, maybe from the beginning there was a Beatles shadow there, because obviously Peter and Gordon's first hit was the song that Paul McCartney wrote. So that maybe put us in their shadow. And I suppose you could say that when Peter and Gordon were lucky enough to continue to have hits, even that they didn't write, maybe that was us stepping out of the shadows. But I think, I mean, my whole career has been a series of surprising steps in a way. When I was a philosophy student at London University, I wasn't expecting a year later to be a pop star.
Who's your favorite philosopher?
Wittgenstein.
Okay, right.
Well, actually, I'm
a Kierkegaard dude, but
I would say Bertrand Russell, but he's way out of fashion these days.
You know, I like John Locke too. I love social contract stuff. That's always good. Locke's always good. We're gonna have a philosophy jam session. We'll talk about some Descartes, baby.
Absolutely.
We'll get in there some Voltaire.
Yeah.
Yeah, but I think there is. You know, you were making these steps to.
Anyway, where was I?
Yeah.
I suppose when I started producing records, you know, that was the first stepping away completely from the Beatles, because obviously the Beatles had something to do with Peter and Gordon's success initially. Paul wrote us that amazing song, or gave us that amazing song that already existed. And when I decided to become a record producer, that was a very conscious ambition on my part.
Yeah.
Though Paul helped, actually, oddly enough, the very first record I ever produced, which was a by a guy called Paul Jones. Do you remember Paul Jones? He was the lead singer of Manfred Mann. Back in the, you know, there she was, just a walking down the street singing. That was Paul Jones, brilliant singer, one of the best harmonica players in the world. I owe him a debt, because he was the first person to say, I'd like you to produce some tracks with me, because nowadays you can prove your ability as a record producer by doing something on your laptop that will blow everyone's socks off.
Oh, yeah.
Back then, unless you could get in a studio with some musicians, it was all talk.
Yeah.
And the first track I ever did was with this guy Paul Jones, and I wanted to make sure I had a really killer rhythm section for the tracking date. So I had Nicky Hopkins on piano, Paul Samuel Smith on bass, who was the bass player in the Yardbirds and also went on to produce Carly Simon and Cat Stevens, and Jeff Beck on guitar.
Oh wow.
And Paul McCartney on drums.
Oh my god,
it's a good rhythm section and a good record.
Yeah, you think?
Yeah,
that is incredible. All right, last song on the record.
So I never quite escaped Paul's influence. I mean, when I produce records,
but that's like, I mean, if there's anybody whose influence you don't escape, that's the person.
Yeah, and then of course when I did James's album, as we talked about, Paul came and played it on Carolina and In My Mind.
Who's like, I just want to go through your phone and see the numbers that you have in there, because I bet it's just, you probably have Voltaire in there.
Oh, definitely, yeah.
All right.
Only a street address, not a, he's old school.
Yeah, he's a male guy.
I have to write to Voltaire with a quill and everything.
All right, last song on the record, because we're skipping all the jams, Hear Me, Lord. To end the record's main group of songs is the most overtly religious song of them all. It's really just a long gospel prayer for forgiveness, help, and guidance, and play the best part, which is the ending, 419.
Oh, hear me, Lord. Hear me, Lord.
I want to know this because you've met so many amazing people and you've worked with so many just great minds and very spiritually in touch people. What is the best advice or guidance you ever got?
Oh, that I ever got. It's usually I'm asked, well, what do you tell people who want to, you know? But gosh, I'm trying to think of advice that I've actually followed and used and then that really did
the curveball. I gave you the curveball.
I mean,
you did.
I can't think of any off the top of my head.
Well, what's the best advice you give?
Well, I think when people, usually it's a question of, you know, nowadays, you know, it's a list of, you know, should I do this? Should I do that? You know, should I be looking for a manager? Should I be looking for an agent? Should I get my music up on iTunes? Should I write songs for other people instead of doing them myself? And the answer is yes to all,
to
of,
all
them.
Of it.
To
yeah.
all of it. You know, because some people screw up and say, you know, you've written a really cool song and you think you're saving it for when you get a record deal and suddenly, you know, Britney Spears wants to do it, you say yes, you know.
Of
you don't
course.
Get all protective. If you're that good, you write another one.
100%.
And the same, you know, when they ask you, should I play this gig? I'm not sure my music will fit in with this band they've asked me to open for. It doesn't matter. If you're good, even if the, you know, the back half of the house isn't listening, if the first three rows are listening and deciding you're really good and they're going to go online afterwards and check you out, that's why you did the gig.
Oh,
you know,
for
so
sure.
It's yes to everything.
It's create. Yeah. Make, don't wait for other people to help you. Just do it.
Yeah, exactly.
All right, you want to hear some, do some facts and get out of here?
Sure.
Let's hear some facts. All right. So George brought Billy Preston in to play keys with the Beatles in 1969. In return, he co-produced his 1970 album Encouraging Words for their Apple Records label. As Billy helped him work on My Sweet Lord, he let him record it first along with the track title and the Beatles then unreleased I've Got a Feeling. It came out 2 months earlier than this album. As someone who has been personally given unreleased Beatles songs by a Beatle to record, if Paul or anyone ever played you one of their new songs and you thought it was awful, would or could you say anything?
I'm very glad that never happened, so I never had to make that decision. No, they never played me a bad song. It would have been tricky.
It really was like that. Everything they were bringing
To us, there were only a couple of songs involved. As you probably know, World Without Love itself was a leftover, unfinished song that they were not going to do, that Paul had abandoned because John didn't like it. So.
Yeah.
And then he wrote a couple specifically for us, Nobody I Know and I Don't Want to See You Again, and Woman. And they were all three, luckily, were great. I mean, it's interesting you mention that, only because people often ask me, is, well, how did you get all those great songs out of the Beatles? And that shows a central misunderstanding of what they saw the role of a songwriter as being. They took their songwriting careers seriously. It was a separate career from being a Beatle. Indeed, one of the questions we all got asked in interviews back in the 60s was, what are you going to do when this is all over? Because it was an absolute conviction that a career as a pop star was 2 years max, you know, and that you'd go back to being a milkman or whatever you were. So they would actually answer that question and did. We will be songwriters. Their heroes were not just Elvis and Eddie Cochran. They were Lieber and Stoller, Goffin and King, Mann and Wilde. They, you know, they thought that was in a way, a more longer lasting profession. So when we had a big hit with World Without Love, which was the accidental leftover song that we got, and that was a story. But after that, of course, all the great songwriters were starting to write songs for us. That's what happens when you have a big hit, you know.
Yeah.
And including, luckily, Paul McCartney, and luckier still, his was the best. He wrote Nobody I Know to be our follow-up, finished with a bridge, ready to go.
Yeah.
We didn't have to go begging. That was what songwriters do, you know.
Yeah.
And we're very glad he did, because it was great.
What songs were brought to you before they were recorded by Paul and John? Like, what do you remember that really just stuck out? That you're shit.
Oh, well, the one that stuck out was, you know, in that house, there was a small music room in the basement. My mother was a professional musician, musician.
Yeah.
She was an oboe player. Indeed, in one of the complex ironies and coincidences, one of the weirdest things is that among her oboe pupils, long before any of this happened, was George Martin.
Oh, no
weird.
Shit.
Very weird. But anyway, that's odd. But no, there was a basement music room in our house in Wimpole Street. And which my mother occasionally used to give private lessons, but increasingly didn't because she was oboe professor at the Royal Academy of Music up the road. And she'd said to Paul, if you ever want to use a piano, you can use that room. And there was that particular day, quite soon after he'd moved in, when John Lennon came over, who by this point I'd also got to know, and the two of them went down to this music room, interestingly, with no guitars, just the piano that was down there. And they were down there for 2 or 3 hours, and then Paul called up the stairs. I was in my bedroom upstairs and asked if I wanted to come down and hear the song they had just finished. So I came down. It's a small room, small upright piano, a music stand, and a two-person sofa. So I sat on the sofa, and they sat side by side on the piano bench, both playing piano, and hammered out this brand new song called I Want to Hold Your Hand, and asked me what I thought. So that I remember.
And you were like, it's garbage. It's that, not going anywhere.
That I do
Let's
remember.
Get George Martin on hobo. That's not hobo, on oboe.
Right.
And the hobo. I mean, this. What are your thoughts hearing that for the first time?
You tell them it's great. And the perhaps the giveaway is what you do, you find yourself doing automatically, is asking them to play it again. Mm. And that's, of course, when you know you got a hit. And and equally convincing is the fact that they were delighted to play it again.
Oh,
they knew it was special.
So it's just a twinkle in their eye and just and like an energy that was just...
Yeah, and you kind of went, I did think at that point, I will remember this. I think being the first person to ever hear that song will turn out to
a
curious honor.
Peter, I can't thank you enough for taking time out to sit down and talk to
me.
No,
it's been good.
This was just such an honor. Thank you.
Oh, my pleasure.
I told you guys this was a banger of an episode. To find out more about Peter Asher and find out about his future appearances, go to his Facebook page, at Peter Asher, and make sure you guys grab a copy of his book, The Beatles from A to Z. Please subscribe on Spotify to the 500. Do it immediately. Pause this, subscribe, come back, because I got to tell you about this. Now, we just listened to George Harrison from 1970. This week, Little Matty Pinfield, our music director, selected Jim James. You might know Jim James as being the front man of My Morning Jacket. We covered the record Zed on this list. He is a solo artist as well and basically made numerous EPs, including one fully comprised of George Harrison covers. Check out My Morning Jacket's fan favorite, One Big Holiday, on Spotify. That is our music of the week. Check out the link at the500podcast.com. And if you're in a band and you want your music played on the 500 website, and we'll talk about it and do all that goodly stuff, I want you guys to send your music to 500podcast@gmail.com. Tell me the album and the artist that influenced you, and we'll make sure it gets up there, guys. Next week is Brian Eno week with his 1973 album, Here Come the Warm Jets. You've got some homework to do. Stay fleecy, listen on Spotify, and a doogle.